الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، وبعد. My most honorable, illustrious, beloved asatiza, teachers, elders, brothers, sisters listening over the speakers and our respected guests, it is an honor beyond words to be asked to come back to one's home. And I regard this as my home, and as all the alumni here, we feel the same way. And to address our fellow brethren, to address those individuals who we used to see regularly, and to be able to speak in front of our teachers so that they have the opportunity and so that we have the opportunity to be corrected by them once again. So under this light and under this umbrella, I would just like to share a few points with you. I was asked not to deliver any formal bayan, or not to discuss any particular ayah, or not to describe any particular hadith. Rather, my job here is to ensure that you understand, as students of this institution, and as those who have taken benefit from this institution, the value of these type of institutions. And in order for me to do so, my words are limited, and my understanding is even more limited. So I thought that perhaps I will share a story with you. And by sharing this story, inshallah ta'ala, we may be able to understand the point that is trying to be brought across. Approximately, or 40, 30 some years ago, there was a very monumentous occasion that was held, and that was the 100 year anniversary of the existence of Darul Uloom Deoband, the madrasa that we regard to be our mother madrasa. The madrasa that we model this building and our teachers model themselves about and across. And during this 100 year anniversary, it was not a small feat, it was a huge, monumentous event. The entire world's focus was on one small village in the north of India. And alhamdulillah, through Allah Ta'ala's fadl, there was an individual who was regarded to be the principal, the rector of that madrasa, whose name was Qari Muhammad Tayyib Saab, rahmatullahi alayhi. And this individual was not a regular alim. He was not a person that someone would just look past and say, oh alhamdulillah, he leads salah in the masjid or this or that. Rather, he was an individual that when he would speak, you would be forced, you would be compelled to listen. And he would speak in such a way that every word that came from his mouth was like an ocean. So he got on this stage in front of hundreds and thousands of people. And he recited one ayah, and the same ayah was recited by this young child that just came up before us, who I'm sure is less than 13 years old. And I want you to understand and visualize that child, and then pay attention to the ayah. He recited the ayah, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن. If the Quran was to be revealed on a mountain, then you would see that the mountain will be pulverized due to the weight of the Quran. He said this ayah, and he said this statement, and then he said, and this is truly prolific, he said, we have all heard this ayah thousands of times before. And we have recited this ayah in our salah, in our regular tilawah, thousands of times before. But the way that he explained that ayah at that time, wallahi, it's amazing. He says that the ayah states that if the Quran was to be revealed on a mountain, the mountain would be pulverized due to the weight of the Quran. He then brought a challenge. He said, if that is the case, then why is it that a 5-year-old child or a 10-year-old child, or a 12-year-old child can recite this Quran, not only recite it, but memorize it, put it into their hearts, and then live their lives. How is that possible? If the mountain couldn't take the weight of the Quran, how is it possible that this child could take the weight of the Quran? And then he waited a few seconds, and then he gave the answer. He didn't let people sit in waham and in thought and coming up with ideas. He gave the answer, and it was said before, but the way that he said it was amazing. Qari Saab rahmatullahi alayhi said that in the world, there are two things. There is the sun and there is the moon. And he said that Allah Ta'ala has many awsaf, many qualities. Amongst them, there are two. One is Jamal and one is Jalal. Jamal is the innate beauty of Allah Ta'ala. And Jamal is the power and the magnificence of Allah Ta'ala. And he said, if you were to look at the creation of Allah Ta'ala, the sun is full of Jalal. It has power and might. You cannot look at it with your naked eye. You get blinded when you look at the sun. And he said that the moon is full of Jamal. It's full of beauty. That when you look at it, your eyes don't feel any pain. You're able to use the light of the moon to guide yourself at night. We can use the moon to calculate and to look at create our calendar. So the moon is full of Jamal. But the thing that is strange is that the light of the moon is taken from the light of the sun. So how is it that the light of the moon is what we call soft, and the light of the sun is so powerful? He then, Barisa, mentioned that there is a transfer process that takes place. That the light of that sun, it's too powerful. So it needs to be transferred in a way that Allah Ta'ala knows to be given to the moon. That same light that you can't look at, when it comes into the moon, it's easy for you to gaze upon. He said, likewise, when the Quran was revealed to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was not possible for us to read it and to understand it and to recite it. But when it came on the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then that transfer process came across. And it went from that Jalal, it went to Jamal. That is what the Quran is. The Quran is the Jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quite a few years ago, there was a similar program in this institution. And we had a sheikh from Egypt, a world-renowned qari, who came, Sheikh Nu'aina, and he recited for maybe 45 minutes or 1 hour. And it was a monumentous occasion. And alhamdulillah, Allah's fadl and karam, I happened to be there at that time. And I will never forget the words of one of my asadiza, that certain people, because it was hot, it's not any fault of their own, they were thinking about something else, they were waiting for food, their eyes were here and there. And this ustad, this teacher, he got up, he took the mic, and he said that, I'm sorry for interrupting the program, but I just want to relate one story to you. And he mentioned the story of a very great alim who happened to be walking by a riverbank. And when he was walking by the riverbank, he was hungry. And he was walking with a zumrah, a group of people, and they were also hungry. And they happened to come across a plank of wood that was covering a hole in the ground. And when he picked up the plank of wood, they happened to notice that there was gold underneath. So the people, they started collecting the gold and taking it, putting it in their pockets and holding it and hoarding it. But this alim, this sheikh, he looked at the lawh, he looked at the piece of wood, and it had Allah Ta'ala's name written on it. What did it have? It had the name of Allah Ta'ala written on it. So the sheikh told the people, you take your gold and go. I found my treasure. And he put that khashab, that piece of wood on his head, and he walked away. When we understand the value of the Quran, then we will understand the value of our teachers, of our asatiza, and by extension, this and many other type of institutions and universities and schools that do nothing, that exist for no other purpose but to connect you and me to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qari Sahib rahmatullahi alayhi, after mentioning this example, he looked at this institution and he said, the purpose of this institution and why it stood for 100 years, not in the shadows, not hiding away, rather it has stood in the face of kufr, in the face of batil, in the face of bid'ah, destroying and decimating anything that came in its path. Why? Because the individuals who led that institution, their focus was one, their focus was to connect people like you and me with Allah Ta'ala. And what did they ask in return? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. My beloved brothers and sisters, one thing that we really need to understand, and one point that we really need to bring into our lives, is the value of not only these type of institutions, but the individuals who establish them. Allama Laqani rahimahullah mentions in his Jawharatul Tawheed, which is a very famous compendium of ash'ar, poetry written on aqidah, the creed of Islam. He mentions مالك وسائر الأئمة كذا أبو القاسم هداة الأمة فواجب تقليد حبر منهم كذا الحق القوم بلفظ يفهم. In two baits, he brought 1,300 plus years of Islam into the into reality. He says مالك, Imam Laqani رحمه الله was from Egypt, he was Maliki. So he says مالك وسائر الأئمة, Imam Malik and the other a'imma, he meant by that Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, rahmatullahi alayhi. He says, you must follow one of these. And then he says, kada Abu al-Qasimi, hudatul ummah. Here, this Abu al-Qasim obviously is not Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He wouldn't come after Imam Malik. He means by this Sayyid al-Ta'ifa, Imam Junayd al-Baghdadi, rahimahullah. So he says, you must follow these individuals. Fawajibun, you must come follow one of these masters of science, of the science, Islamic sciences. كَذَا الْحَقَ الْقَوْمُ بِلَفْضٍ يُفْهَمُ. Likewise, the Ummah, Islam, the Muslims, as Dr. Saab was mentioning, that one of the ways of halal entertainment that we have, and one way that this Ummah has taken halal entertainment, is by listening to the Qur'an, and by implementing the words of the Qur'an, and by taking lazzat and understanding the beauty of the Qur'an. Likewise, another part of our Islam, and another integral staple in our deen, is learning to follow and learning to build a connection and learning to build to establish a connection with the scholars of deen. Hazrat Thanvi, Hakim al-Ummah, Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi, rahmatullahi alayh, he once sat in the company of his sheikh, Haji Saab Imdadullah Muhajir Makki, rahimahullah, a master of masters. And he asked him a very innocent question. He said, all of these theories that you're talking about, dard-e-dil, right? Feeling the pain of Allah Ta'ala in your heart, and building a relationship with Allah Ta'ala, and looking at the world through the lens of the love of Allah Ta'ala, he says, these are all sort of intangible and weird theories. He says, how do I bring them into reality? How can I really feel them? So Haji Saab gave him an instruction. He said, Mia Ashraf Ali, put your two hands together. And he said, Rabb. And he told him to rub, and he told you to rub, and rub, and rub, and rub. He said, what do you feel? He said, I feel heat. He says, if you put two pieces of flesh together and rub, and you feel heat, then imagine when you rub the Qur'an of Allah Ta'ala, which is the living speech of Allah Ta'ala, you rub that on your heart, then what feeling will come? And heat is a sign. Heat is an indication of life. So our hearts that have become dead, due to the exposure of the filth that is around us, due to living a life of heedlessness and negligence of Allah Ta'ala, we can bring life into them once again. How do we do this? By bringing the Qur'an into our life. And once we bring the Qur'an into our life, subhanallah, in the last, I would say, 50 to 60 years, there have been a few individuals who have stood on this platform of bringing the Qur'an into life and into existence. And in my limited understanding, perhaps a name that you have heard, that's why I'm saying his name, one individual is Hazrat Maulana, they used to call him Muhyi al-Sunnah, the one who would give life to Sunnah, Hazrat Maulana Abrar al-Haqsa, rahmatullahi alayhi, a prolific scholar of deen. What did he used to say? He used to say one amazing thing. He would say that the way to bring Quran into your existence, the very first way, because he would speak to Dihati people, he would speak to villagers who didn't have much exposure to Islam. So they would say, Shaykh, we haven't learned, and we don't have time to learn, and we don't have the resources to learn. So how do we bring the beauty of this Qur'an into our lives? He would say, the first thing you need to do is to make ihtiram and respect the Qur'an. Have respect for the Qur'an. So they would say, Shaykh, we all respect the Qur'an. What does it mean to respect the Qur'an? He says that you must respect the people of the Qur'an. You must respect the people of the Qur'an. And it said about him that if there was ever a hafid in front of them, he would never stretch his feet to the hafid. That if there was ever somebody walking, he happened to be riding, or he happened to be above someone, and there was a person who was studying Quran or reading Quran, and he was lower than him in height, he would get off of his horse, or he would get off of his conveyance, he would get out of the car to allow that person to pass. This is, now many of us think, oh man, that's extreme. How can you apply that into this existence? How can you apply that theory into our time now? That's too much. But just start it respecting the Quran and by extension the people of Quran. And wallahi, I swear to you, when it's not my promise, it is the promise of Allah Ta'ala, you will find such enjoyment and such happiness in your heart and such contentment in your life that wallahi, there is nothing that is like that. I make dua that Allah Ta'ala gives us tawfiq to make amal what is said. If anything wrong was said, I ask your forgiveness. And jazakumullah khairan once again to come to this program and to benefit. And inshallah ta'ala, the program will continue after Muslim.